On behalf of the members of the Executive Committee of Confederation, I most cordially welcome our very popular and highly respected Rashtrapati ji. The Electoral College, consisting of members of Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, and MLAs of all the state legislatures, elected Pranab as President of India on 25th July 2012 with a thumping majority supported by a large number of political parties. Earlier, he had been very successful political career of over 5 decades of exemplary service to the nation. Our Rashtrapati ji at the age of 81 is working 365/24. I propose that our judges should not be retired at least till they attain 81. Our Rashtrapati ji has tremendous regards for our judiciary. He, for the first time, set up the practice to invite the newly appointed honorable judges of the Supreme Court, along with their spouse, to have one-to-one interaction. Our legal fraternity very much appreciates this new tradition set up by Pranabda. Our Rashtrapati ji is a man of great experience in governance, with rare distinction of having served different times, handled successfully all important portfolios. Our Rashtrapati ji has extensive experience and interaction with several international organizations, including the United Nations General Assembly, IMF, World Bank, Commonwealth Head of Government, Asian Development Bank, African Development Bank, etc., etc., etc. His Excellency has authored several books on a large number of topics, including on nation building, Indian economy, and large number of other subjects. On entering Rashtrapati Bhavan, the Rashtrapati ji has modernized and made large number of reforms in Rashtrapati Bhavan. Our Rashtrapati ji also started various noble initiatives for senior citizens, differently able children and others. The doors of Rashtrapati Bhavan have been opened for we the people of India. Last year, a record number of 8 lakh people visited Rashtrapati Bhavan. A record number of more than 6.7 lakhs people toured the Mughal Garden in 1 month. I most cordially welcome Honorable Mr. Justice J.S. Keher, the Chief Justice of India and the Karta of the joint family of Bar and Bench. We are very lucky to have received His Lordship's guidance, help, and encouragement in arranging this seminar. Our Chief Justice wants to do a lot for the administration of justice. He is devoting all his time, energy for improvement of our justice delivery system from top to bottom. He is pained by the delay in disposal of cases and has started remedial measures. In fact, we are very happy that 3 constitution bench is being constituted to be heard during vacation, and I can say that the bar will cooperate in the disposal of these cases during the vacation. I most cordially welcome Honorable Mr. Justice Deepak Mishra, the senior most judge of Supreme Court, who has always made sure that justice reaches the grassroots level also. He has a roadmap for improvements. He is doing a lot for legal aid for the poor and the disabled litigants throughout our country. Justice Mishra has been extremely helpful in guiding us to make this seminar successful. The last seminar Confederation held was in Bhubaneswar, and Justice Mishra supported us so much, and it was also a very, very successful seminar. We are indebted to honorable judges of the Supreme Court who are going to chair 12 working sessions, 6 today and 6 tomorrow. Their help and guidance has been tremendous. I thank Dr. Thomas Kunz, representative of India, and Mr. Pankaj Madan of Konard Enduroo for their great support in this seminar. I cannot welcome Mr. Harish Salve since he is the host, founding member of the Confederation. Many times he has been offered to take over as the president of the Confederation of Indian Bar by me and all my colleagues unanimously, but God knows why he keeps on proposing my name. I most cordially welcome my friend Arun Mohan, senior advocate. He has written a book titled Financial Management of Justice System and the Court Fees for the Benefit of Legal Fraternity. I also most cordially welcome Honorable Judges of Supreme Court, former Judges of the Supreme Court, as well as the High Courts, senior advocates, professors, students, and other delegates who have come from Kashmir to Kanyakumari to attend and participate in this All India seminar. We express our gratitude to Honorable Mr. M. Hamid Ansari, Vice President, for his message, and also Ms. Arun Jetley, Honorable Finance Minister, for his message of good wishes. I do not elaborate on the theme of the seminar and topics of the working sessions. Our seminar paper volume contains thought-provoking articles written by experts, including 5 former judges of Supreme Court, members of the bar, teachers, and students. You will have opportunity to interact in the 12 working sessions, which will be chaired by the honorable judges of the Supreme Court. In order to ensure that the junior advocates or law teachers and students are not deprived in participating in this seminar, we are not charging any registration fee from any delegate. We depend on the voluntary contribution made or to be made by our senior advocates, law firms, and advocates who are doing well in the profession. Many members have already made their contribution, and I'm sure the shortfall will be taken care of. Ladies and gentlemen, I welcome each one of you and request you to be in Vigyan Bhavan today and tomorrow. Thank you.
I request Mr. Praveen H. Parekh, President of the Confederation of Indian Bar, to kindly present a memento to Honorable Rashtrapati Ji. I request Mr. M.T. George, Secretary General, to kindly present a floral bouquet to Honorable Rashtrapati Ji, please. I request Mr. Ashok Gupta, the Treasurer, to kindly present a memento to Honorable Mr. Justice J.S. Kehar, Chief Justice of India, please. And I request Mr. Vishal Prasad to kindly present Chief Justice of India with a floral bouquet, please. I request Ms. Ritika Sethi to kindly present a memento to Honorable Mr. Justice Deepak Mishra, the senior most judge of the Supreme Court. And I request Mr. Sandeep Dubey to present a floral bouquet to Honorable Mr. Justice Deepak Mishra, please. I request Dr. Thomas Kunze, representative for India, Conrad Adenauer Stiftung, to kindly present a bouquet of flowers to Shri Harish N. Salve, please. I request Mr. Utkarsh Dixit to present a bouquet of flowers to Shri Arun Mohan, please.
I welcome you on behalf of the Confederation for this conference. Mr. Parekh mentioned about why I insist he continues as the president. The answer is not far to seek. Year after year, he turns out a conference better than the previous, selecting topics which are relevant, which are contemporary, and the success of his conference can be measured by the fact that we have had the privilege of the Honorable President, the Chief Justice, and dignitaries of that stature inaugurating our conferences. And I welcome you to one more of such conferences, where you will be discussing 2 issues which concern India, and concern India gravely. The first is the issue of economic reform, a process we embarked upon in 1991, and which at best can be called work in progress. We have serious ideological issues to resolve on what kind of economy we want before we settle into measures of economic reform. It is gratifying to see increased public acceptance of the hard reality that the laws of economics are ruthless. They don't understand romance. They don't understand any kind of softness. And we have to come to terms with realities of the globe, which is an increasingly shrinking space, if we want India to have her rightful place in the sun. The second topic of equal importance, and which of late has come to occupy significant space in dialogue, is electoral reform. And I'm happy that this conference will explore the overlay of the two, i.e. economic reforms and its implications on electoral issues. Raising of funds for elections is always a complex issue. As anybody who is even superficially familiar with the extremely difficult exercise called elections, and much as we may berate the system, we must realize that the soul of Indian democracy is changing governments by the ballot. And this is achieved through the process of elections. And we have to acknowledge that money is the lifeblood of elections. You cannot conduct elections without funds, but you must also recognize that money can be the biggest evil in elections when it is used to skew results. Raising of funds is a complex issue where political parties committed to transparency, committed to good governance, have to raise funds. And today's monies can only be raised from the corporate sector in an India where feudalism has been successfully abolished. I hope in the discussions, in the technical sessions, some of the issues which impinge upon state funding of elections will be discussed. There is an idea which I have had and which we have discussed, which I have at least tried to introduce in some discussions, of an election cess to raise monies kept at the disposal of the Election Commission, who can use it to create infrastructure which it can reasonably distribute amongst the different contending political parties. The government can partly fund elections not by writing checks, but by making government infrastructure available to the contending political parties and campaigners in a fair manner determined by the Election Commission. And today, one of the most powerful means of communication is the electronic means of communication. All electronic communication uses a precious resource which belongs to all of us, spectrum. And I don't see why, as a condition of using the spectrum, they cannot be compelled to allow a certain amount of time or space to the Election Commission to be distributed amongst the contenders. If we can reduce the cost of elections, we can certainly then strive towards cleaning up the funding of the electoral process. These and many other issues of interest lie ahead of you in the next 2 days, and I would join Mr. Parekh in strongly commending that you attend the technical sessions, which range right from whether the amending act of the arbitration law of 2015 is good or whether, as some of us consider in certain respects, a remedy worse than the disease, extending from there to elections and good governance. I'm sure you will have an extremely instructive time in the next 2 days attending these workshops. I welcome you once again to the conference and thank all of you for being here.
While discussing about this topic, I thought the best way to express, to narrate an anecdote. It was 1960. John F. Kennedy was running for the presidency of United States of America. There was immense rumor that his healthy father was making enormous efforts to buy the election. The rumor began to garner, and Kennedy lost track of communicating with the people with regard to his message. Then he had an idea. Kennedy was young, Kennedy was handsome, and one day at an annual dinner party where many people were present, he said,
Yesterday night, my father sent me a telegram. It was fictional. And the telegram read, I quote, Jack, don't buy a single vote more than necessary. I'll be damned if I'm going to pay for a landslide. The said anecdote has its relevance. It conveys that purchasing power has no room in an election. It is because in an elevated constitutional democracy, purity of election and credibility of the process of election have their signification. Democracy and pre-elections in a democratic body polity have been regarded as a part of the basic structure of the Constitution, and therefore free and fair elections are imperative for the growth of a healthy democracy in a country. The power of a voter has been lucidly stated by Sir Winston Churchill, which has been approved by Justice Krishna Iyer in one of his landmark judgments in Mahinder Singh Gill. And the quotation from Churchill reads thus, at the bottom of all tributes, paid to the democracy is a little man, walking it a little boat, with a little pencil, making a little cross on a little bit of paper. No amount of rhetoric or voluminous discussion can possibly diminish the overwhelming importance of the point. I would like to say the aforesaid utterance should not be treated as a Churchillian hyperbole, but the true spirit of democracy. The election being extremely important to a democracy, there is absolute necessity for conducting the same in a free and fair manner, having economic purity. You see, the concept of constitutional expectation and the constitutional trust which flow from the Constitution itself is inhered in the democratic way the government comes into existence. Holding of an election not only has to be bereft of criminalization, because Supreme Court in a number of cases have commented on criminalization of politics. I emphasize it should be bereft or sans criminalization, but it must be perceived as an activity involving norms of fiscal morality. Our ancients, the Shastrakars, has laid down the guidelines for Arthasuchi, Baksuchi, and Karmasuchi. The electoral reforms have to be perceived from these spectrums. Disclosure of antecedents will come within the ambit of Karmasuchi. The nature of campaign shall be included within the conception of Baksuchi. The manner, the method, and the course adopted would come within the umbrella of Arthasuchi. Thus, the modus operandi in one's conduct in an election is of paramount importance. The discussion as regards the economic reforms in respect of electoral issues can be viewed from many a prism. In the present system, a candidate is required to file his accounts of expenditure before the competent authority, and for the same, there is a prescription of time. Sometimes it is noticed there is violation, and a plea is advanced in the court that this is a matter to be adjudicated before the election tribunal. Despite the court repelling the said submission, the lapse is absolutely visible. Way back in 1996, the Supreme Court had to utter, for democracy to survive, rule of law must prevail, and it's necessary that the best available men should be chosen as people's representatives for proper governance of the country. This can be best achieved through men of high moral and ethical values who win elections on a positive vote, obtained on their own merit, and not by the negative vote process of elimination based on comparative demerits of candidates. From 2000 onwards, the Supreme Court, with the aid of interpretative process, has delivered certain judgments with regard to reforms, that's like disclosure of antecedents, disclosure of assets and liabilities, disclosure of criminal antecedents in panchayat elections. In panchayat election matter, Mr. Salve assisted the court as an amicus curiae, that if you do not disclose your criminal antecedents, that tantamounts to undue influence. Thereafter, the principle of none of the above, all kinds of electoral reforms has been brought in through electoral process by interpreting Article 324 of the Constitution. I have called out certain ideas. They might be sounding abstract, but you have to find out where lies the precepts and how the idea works into concrete parameters. That should be the barometer of discussion when you discuss in the technical sessions. According to me, in the perspective of purity of election, there can be five guidelines, and that may be reflective of economic reforms. One, every candidate contesting an election must bear in mind that contesting in an election is not an investment. Two, propagation of one's idea to be successful in an election should be founded on incremental exposure of one's ability to serve the constituency and ultimately the nation. Third, discussion, debate, and deliberations are required to be holistic and remotely not suggesting any kind of exercise of power, money, or money power, because one may have pleasure to have money, but it has unpleasant component in an election when money changes hands. Four, framing of guidelines as regards the expenditure structuralism by common consensus and to treat it as a model code of conduct has to be regarded as primary. The said consensus gives rise to model code of conduct and has to be treated with willing acceptance with the scope and ambit of Article 324 of the Constitution. It should be by way of evolution, keeping in view the legitimate expectation of a citizenry in a democratic body polity. And five, a candidate and the voter are to remember the old saying, out of debt is out of danger. When you don't owe any money to anyone, you are out of danger. In conclusion, I would like to say, if the little man is going to the booth with the hope that he has not been tempted, it shall be the glorious day for democracy. And if he feels that he has been a part of the investment, that is indicative of absence of economic morality in an election. Thank you for being present.
Shri Arun Mohan, senior advocate, has written a book titled Financial Management of the Justice System and Court Fees, specially for this seminar. May I request Shri Arun Mohan to kindly present the first copy of this book to the Honorable President of India and the other dignitaries on the stage, and then we'll have a wonderful photo for everyone. So let's give a warm round of applause, ladies and gentlemen.
It is indeed my pleasure to be part of this seminar on economic reforms with reference to electoral issues organized by the Confederation of Indian Bar. I choose to commence on the same theme as my esteemed brother Justice Deepak Mishra, with reference to the words of Sir Winston Churchill, with reference to that little man, And this will be the focus of the conversation that I choose to have with you today. Under the Constitution, this little voter selects representatives who will generate national wealth and use it in the manner laid down by the directive principles while observing the fundamental rights. No political party can work contrary to the directive principles, since these principles are fundamental in the governance of the country. The directive principles and fundamental rights are compulsive constitutional manifesto of every political party. Since elected representatives take their oath of office under the Constitution, an economic system which provides for good governance in terms of the constitutional mandate binds political parties which come to power after election. The question, therefore, is, what economic system is constitutionally postulated? For generation of natural wealth, and what are the ends for which this wealth is to be used? The directive principles in articles, sub-articles 39B and C clearly lay down the economic organization of India's resources. Sub-articles 39B and C require the state to secure the ownership and control of material resources and to so distribute all such material resources as would best subserve the common good. The state is also required to secure that the operation of the economic system does not result in concentration of wealth and means of production to the common detriment. The ends for which the national wealth is generated by such an economic system are required to be prioritized through Articles 46 and 47. The emphasis is on nutrition, public health, as well as educational, economic, and social justice interests of scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, and other weaker sections of the society. The economic system so prescribed for such ends and those provided for through Articles 39E, F, and Articles 41 and 43 must result in a social order of equality of opportunity as required by Article 38. The entire debate of economic reforms, therefore, has to be how to organize the ownership and control of material resources of the country on the one hand, and on the other, how to operate the economic system for delivering good governance to citizens by constitutional means and constitutional ends. A quick look at the election manifesto concerning the economic reforms agenda of most national political parties show remarkable similarities on foreign direct investment, exports, imports, manufacture, taxation, trade and labor issues. But truly, the real problem about economic reforms arises in their implementation. This problem arises because the Constitution treads the distribution and use of national wealth generated by the economic system as an integral part of the generation of such wealth. Interestingly, political parties and their manifestos compartmentalize the generation of wealth separately from its end use. Accordingly, legislative and executive measures of economic reform do not address the question about the impact of such measures on scheduled castes, scheduled tribes, and other weaker sections, or with reference to children and women who are compelled to work during their childhood or beyond their age or strength. Their compulsion is because of economic necessity. This synergy in the constitutionally mandated unity of the social, economic, and political measures for ensuring justice is the call of the hour. Economic reforms are confined only to economic growth and not linked to social and political justice. Unconstitutional economics for economic growth produces serious socio-economic ills. Economic reforms take center stage, while democracy, in terms of the priorities in the directive principles, is overlooked. Whereas the Constitution requires just the opposite. Consequently, electoral politics does not tell the citizens as to what kind of reform they are entitled to under the Constitution. How does electoral politics achieve this? It's always very easy to speak on constitutional values. And it's all the more easy if you speak in abstract, as I have. I've learned this abstract art from my brother Justice Mishra, who more often than not speaks in abstract. I may confess that I profess no educational or professional expertise in economic matters or on economic planning. But I wish to share my views with you as I individually perceive them, so as to concretize whatever I have stated in abstract. My illustration and my views are personal. And many of you may not find favor with those, because, as Mr. Salve had said, we must strive economically to achieve the rightful position in the globe. Values have evolved, and terms of the world trend have transformed generationally. I do not wish to deal with present issues. My example is therefore based on the past. I take you back to pre-independence India. I take you to my state, Punjab. I belong to Punjab. I best understand Punjab. A land of five rivers, with all its people having the same complexion. All of them with a similar physique. All of them speak the same language, share the same jokes, eat the same kind of food. The staple food is just the same. Their livelihood is mainly similar, mainly agricultural. They are all progressive, forward-looking, ready to take challenges, move from agriculture to towns. That's at the time of partition. And then the partition. 70 years have gone by since then. Part of Punjab is now in Pakistan. So we have the same complexion, the same language, the same terrain, with no mineral resources, the same kind of livelihood for people who now live in the Punjab in Pakistan and the people who now live in the Punjab in India. Pakistan continues with the pre-independence feudal system. Individual families own hundreds of villages, not hundreds of acres, hundreds of villages. All the rest are mainly agricultural peasants. They live in the same mud huts as they lived in before partition. When the feudal lord visits the village, they stand by the road to welcome him, to show respect to him, for he is their lord and master. That's how Pakistan is. What did we do in India? In India, after partition, we adopted two very definitive measures. One, land reforms. Two, the Industrial Disputes Act. We all understand what land reforms did, and we all understand why there are smaller holdings in India and there are larger holdings in Pakistan. We understand that. And we understand how, therefore, resources came to be distributed between larger sections of the community than remaining with the feudal lords. But what about the second measure, the Industrial Disputes Act? It's not an act which is presently acclaimed in any way. But what did it do then? It ensured to a workman a steady income. It ensured to the workman the sustenance of his job, which in turn gave him a stable livelihood. The protected workman was in a position to educate his children. If he was unskilled, he educated them to be semi-skilled. If he was semi-skilled, he educated them to be skilled. And then when they achieved this level, they came forward to further education. And in these 70 years of India, India brought the enormous below poverty line people into the presently enormous middle class Indians. This is the economic reform that deals with and caters to the directive principles I have referred to in an abstract manner. We may think differently today. We may think globally today, that we must. But we must also think how to cater to those people who still need to be brought up. It is this economic reform that has made all the difference today between India and Pakistan. One can attempt to underline the limits of the overlooked form of democracy in the Indian context by visiting its electoral politics since the initiation of neoliberal economic reforms and take note of the marked discord between the two. Electoral politics in recent India centers around the mobilization and politicization of the social groups which had for long remained politically dormant. These groups were either economically poor or were identity groups which had been historically disadvantaged. Election studies consistently illustrate that in recent decades, the voting turnout of these marginal sections has been higher than the average turnout. This increased turnout is taken as an indication of the expansion in awareness and political involvement and participation of these marginalized sections to express their franchise. This has caused unprecedented volatility in the electoral outcome, forcing political parties to seek new reforms of political alignments, social engineering, and support. The general conclusion is that this volatility is good for democracy because it reflects increasing empowerment of the poor and the marginalized. During this recent 2014 election, one of the major political parties' manifesto titled, "Your Voice, Our Pledge for 2014-19, mentioned prominently its commitment to broaden and deepen economic reforms, to attain 8 to 10% economic growth, to ensure efficiency and competitiveness in all production sectors. For this purpose, the party promised incentives for increasing foreign direct investment. The party promised to continue with disinvestments, though in a selective manner. The manifesto provided an economic roadmap for 2014 to 2019 with 10 important tasks to be undertaken, such as fiscal consolidation, current account deficit, price stability and growth, manufacturing, financial sector reforms, subsidies, urbanization, skill development and sharing responsibilities between the states and the center. This political party also outlined the immediate priorities to ensure that the economy gets back on track with the target of 8% growth. But this manifesto did not indicate anywhere any linkage between these economic reforms and the constitutional goal of social economic justice. Now, the manifesto of the other political party. The manifesto of the other political party was titled as Ek Bharat, Shresht Bharat, Agenda for Development, Good Governance and Peace. Its proposals under the head Economic Revival included measures such as barring the multi-band retail sector, foreign direct investment to be allowed in sectors wherever needed, for job and asset creation, infrastructure and acquisition of niche technology and specialized expertise, implementing an open sky policy and continuing the privatization process, including in the mining sector, to enhance and realize the hidden wealth in the public sector undertakings. The manifesto also promised to provide a non-adversarial and conducive tax environment by rationalization and simplification of the existing tax regime. Ladies and gentlemen, even this manifesto did not show any specific linkage to the constitutional goal of socio-economic justice. The separate programs for the poor, the marginalized, the scheduled castes, the scheduled tribes, and the other backward classes have no linkage to the economic revival program. While the manifesto mentions social justice and social harmony, there is hardly any reference to economic justice and economic harmony as the basis for the postulated constitutional goal of an integrated social order which ensures economic and political justice. Electoral promises routinely remain unfulfilled. The reasons for this gap between electoral promises and its fulfillment does not become an electoral issue. The process of winning elections, it seems, takes the toll. the process of so powerfully has the political segment swung towards privatization that the mainstream left parties, which had otherwise described economic reforms as anti-people and criticized other parties for adopting or endorsing them, did allow for disinvestments of the loss-making public sector undertakings if the same were to take place in a transparent manner. That apart, religion, not economics, takes center stage during electioneering. Caste issues are projected in different ways to ensure a majority in each constituency. Economic reforms become an electoral issue in the constitutional sense are indeed a far cry. No consequences occur whether promises are fulfilled or not. Every political party brazenly finds an excuse of not reaching consensus amongst allied partners. Even our legal system provides for no consequences to be suffered by political parties if promises made in the manifesto are not fulfilled. Uninformed citizenry with a short-term memory forgets. The election manifestos, therefore, become a mere piece of paper. The Supreme Court in S. Subramaniam Balaji in 2013 recognized the post-election plight of the helpless voter and directed the Election Commission to frame guidelines with regard to the contents of election manifestos after consultation with all recognized political parties. Accordingly, the Election Commission framed these guidelines and made these a part of the Model Code of Conduct. The Model Code of Conduct, apart from being a code for guidance of political parties, comes into play only for a short period between the notification of the election and the declaration of the result. Political parties cannot be held to their promises in their manifestos after the results are declared. The Supreme Court has shown a gradual way forward in the Subramaniam Balaji's case. It has held that although the promises in the election manifesto cannot be construed as corrupt practice, the reality cannot be ruled out that promises to distribute freebies undoubtedly influences people, and as such, it strikes at the root of a free and fair election to a large degree. Accordingly, the court directed the Election Commission to frame guidelines for manifestos after consulting all the recognized national and state political parties, as an election manifesto is directly associated with the electoral process. On this basis, further guidelines were introduced in the Model Code of Conduct. On May 14 last year, the Election Commission issued a notice to a political party pointing out that the promises made in its manifesto for the Tamil Nadu state elections violated the guidelines. It directed the party to explain the non-compliance and the rationale for the promises while indicating the ways and means for financing these promises. On March 6 this year, the Election Commission issued notice to a political party on account of the statement made by a chief minister at an election meeting asking the voters to keep the money distributed by them. But remember his party's symbol while casting their vote. On March 11 this year, the Election Commission rejected the explanation of a political party that the statement merely asked voters to make an educated choice. The Election Commission conveyed a warning to the party after stating that public utterances which amount to encouraging bribery in elections constituted an electoral offense and a corrupt practice. On January 16 this year, the Election Commission issued a notice to yet another political party asking voters to accept money being distributed by a political party but to vote for it. The Commission sought an explanation from the party since it was prima facie of the opinion that the statement violated the Model Code of Conduct. The Election Commission has invoked in each of the above cases the principle of free and fair elections. the fundamental economic reforms directly related to elections and the manner in which these elections are held are what you will debate and discuss during the sessions that you are going to hold. There are many serious issues. I've tried to highlight only a few of them based on constitutional morality and importance, without which constitutional democracy is not possible. Perhaps these thoughts may be the basis of a wider debate at your hands during your discussions in this seminar. I wish you all an enlightening and successful professional panel discussion. Thank you very much.
I am indeed very happy to have this opportunity of sharing some of my perceptions on the issues of economic reforms with the reference to electoral issues. For 2 days, the experts will analyze the issues, and no doubt there will be an enlightened deliberation in this 2 days conference. I would like to place certain observations for your consideration, which as a practicing political activists and spending almost a quarter century in the government of India as minister, both in the post-reforms and pre-reformed era, and also participating in the general elections to Lok Sabha, not many times, 4 times, and not with much credible results. Twice I lost, twice I won. So it is almost equal. From that perspective, I am raising certain issues which have emerged and staring at our face. And in the electoral reforms, I am not deliberating on the economic reforms and its relevance that we will have to do from the technical session. But on broad economic reforms, I have shared, and in one way, I am one of the small actors in the process. The major electoral reforms, which I do feel we should consider, the huge number of electors in the last Lok Sabha elections, 800 million voters were there. They were to elect 543 members from territorial constituencies all over India. I'm not talking right now about the 4,125 MLAs who are elected from their respective territorial constituencies by the same number of electors. The second issue which is coming, very recently when the issues were debated, almost every time on different occasions, Parliament has expressed its views, members have expressed their concerns. One pertinent question has been raised challenging the very modality of the type of election we have, first by post, that from 1952 to till date, no political party in India has won election, whatever be the number of strength in the House, by scoring 51% of the votes. The highest number of votes recorded by a political party, first under the leadership of Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, Indian National Congress, in 1957, second general election, and in 1984, under the leadership of his grandson, Rajiv Gandhi, they were near 50%, but not 50%. Nehru scored 48%, Rajiv scored 48.6%. So the question comes that vast number of votes polled, whether they could have some sort of representation, in other words, the listing system, so that there is involvement. The third problem, which our electoral system and administration comes, Chief Justice very emphatically and relevantly pointed out that accountability to the electorate. But the system of parliamentary government is such that if somebody gets 40, 51 out of 100, 51 has all the rights, authorities, and in our electoral process, less than 51, they have all the rights and authorities, but no responsibilities. The rest, those who are getting less than that, they have no responsibilities. In our system, administrative system, there is no possibility. The type of administration and government we have, unless we have a coalition government, the views of the other components hardly get reflected in the administration of the government. And look at the scenario which has been practiced from 1952. 52 to 77, absolute majority of one party. 77, a short-lived coalition for 3 years. 80 to 95, 15 years, another single-party majority rule. And when we had the coalition, we had to pay a very heavy price for the coalition. For example, in terms of stability, between 89 to 99, in these 10 years, as per constitutional practice, there should have been three elections, 89, 94, and 99. But actually, what happened? 89, 91, 96, 98, 99. 5 general elections took place. To avoid that, fragile, opportunistic coalition form, government was formed, but it did not last. And some of these issues, to my mind, can never be addressed through the legal system. Some of these issues are to be addressed by the norms, voluntary code of conduct to be developed by the political parties as an institution. And if we have that, then perhaps many of these issues could be addressed. The third point on which I would like the distinguished and informed audience to consider and deliberate. House of Commons has 600 seats. But in Indian Parliament, up to now, till 2030, we shall have to live with 543. Should we increase the number? Obviously, there is a case, but our population was frozen by an amendment of the Constitution, 46th Amendment, 1976, 42nd Amendment, 1976. That population was frozen at the 1971 census figure. And on the basis of that, delimitations took place. Thereafter, after long years, geographical delimitations have taken place, but number of seats remain the same. Therefore, whether we should have more number of seats. And correlated question should be that after all, our system, parliament is not merely, when I talk of parliament, I also refer to state assembly, I imply that. It is just not merely a deliberative body, but it is a decision-making body. The time available for the discussion, debate, and finally decision, I'm not talking of disruption, which is totally aberration, and which should be avoided under any circumstances. But even healthy debate, dissension, and finally decision. We are to take the decision with the complex administrative system nowadays. Do we have any mechanism through which we can allow the people's representatives to have full say? Take the case of budget. The budget presented by the finance minister, which is debate is going to be over, and after many years, we are going to pass the budget by the end of the financial year, 31st March. No vote on account was taken. I congratulate the government for making the necessary changes. Otherwise, it happened that budget allocations are made. Department knows, state government knows what are the plan assistance available. But when actual sanction goes and reach the destination, hardly any time is left, working season substantially is lost. These issues are being addressed separately. But coming to the election and conduct of the election, there also you shall have to think very seriously. Another idea is there, formation of the political party, which is very important institutions in any form of democracy. It is normally based on the right to form the associations under Article 19. Political party as an institution has been referred before 10th schedule. There was no reference in the text of the constitution. Only two laws made under the constitution, People's Representation Act 1951 and 1956, mentioned the political party. But the most vital instrument of the parliamentary system or democratic system, the political party as an institution, what would be its role? And what type of discipline you can enforce? Through whom you can enforce? Can judiciary take this responsibility? Can election commission take this responsibility? Can the mandate of the Election Commission beyond Article 324 be expanded? I'm sorry, I thought that I'm a little out of context perhaps, but I thought that some of these issues, which are truly problematic, I would request this distinguished assembly to consider it, because I'm looking forward to your deliberations, and I do feel if substantive concrete suggestions come, it will have its impact, that how best we can utilize our constitution, our democratic method, because I have seen in my life, you have, everyone has seen. Sometimes I wonder at the amazing fact that a country having 1.3 billion people, in our everyday life we use 207 languages in some parts of the country, practice 7 religions, large number of human males belonging to Caucasian groups, Dravidian ethnicity, and Mongoloid, yet living under one flag, one system, one constitution, and the harmony which prevails, the huge diversity which we are managing despite our shortcomings in the system, is truly admirable. And keeping that, what best we can do to fill in the shortcomings, I would like this distinguished gathering to ponder over it. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.